Well, you all have been in a series that's talking about faith, and I'm very excited about this series, Everyday People, Uncommon Faith. I got to be with the campus pastors when they started formulating this entire series for the summer. And when you think about faith, it takes faith every time you drive over a bridge. It takes faith every time you get in a boat and head out on a lake to know that it's not going to leak or there's not a hole in it somewhere. Every time you get on an airplane and it takes off, you have confidence and faith that the pilot knows what he's doing, that it's been well engineered, that they've taken great care of it and maintained it, and that it's actually going to go in the air, right? Those are things that you just take by faith. When you tithe, it's a step of faith. When you witness and share your testimony with someone else, it's a step of faith. And all of those things help to bolster or deepen our faith. Sometimes it's risky. Sometimes it feels reckless to take a step of faith. But good things happen when we have our faith in the right person. I had a wedding on Friday night, and you've been to plenty of weddings, I'm certain, as I have. And there's that moment in the service where the groom is standing there and he's nervously staring at the back door, right? And you've seen all these people come walking down and all eyes are focused at that back door. And that was the situation Friday night. And everybody was looking back there and there was this pause. And there was a pause. And it kept on going and kept on going. And I'm standing there right next to the groom and this dude is nervous. And he is sweating, and the longer it went before that door opened, the more nervous he got. The more nervous I got, too. I got to be honest. Because it's like, okay. And I'm thinking, I just saw her a few minutes ago. I really think she's going to come out, right? And sure enough, after about an eight-second wait, the doors opened, the music changed, and he breathed a sigh of relief. It's risky. When you take a step of faith, it's reckless when you take a step of faith. Okay, will she be there when the door is open? Will she come down? Will she take me for the rest of her life? As we learn about faith, I want us to take a look in the Bible in Mark chapter 5. So if you have your Bible, I'm going to encourage you at all of our campuses just to turn to Mark chapter 5, and we're going to look at a story. It's a great story of faith. It's a reckless faith. It's a faith that just follows its heart. And in Mark chapter 5, it's a story that is a great story tucked inside of another great story. Here's the setting. Jesus has been doing a number of miracles, and he's done miracles that showed his power over nature, over sickness, over demons, over death. And he's been displaying his power often. And now an influential man by the name of Jairus comes up to him and says, "My daughter is very sick." Now, Jairus was a synagogue ruler. He was a leader. He was a cultural influencer. He has faith in Christ's power to heal. And this situation is a desperate situation. And he begs for Jesus to come to his house. And he's desperate for Jesus to do something. And without hesitation, Jesus goes with him. And there's this throng of people that join in on the journey so that they can have a front row seat to see if this miracle this might happen, if there might be something that Jesus can do to help this little girl. But a bold and reckless woman of faith is going to insert herself into the story while Jesus is on this desperate mission. Let me try to paraphrase what happens in Mark chapter 5. She is a woman that we would have never remembered had she not crossed the path of one that we can never forget. And we don't even know her name. The Bible doesn't even tell us her name. She remains nameless. All we know is that she is one of those vast company of mortals who for a moment found her immortality and light in the company of Jesus Christ. But who she was not nearly as important as why she had come. She thought, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, then I will be made well. She'd suffered from an incurable hemorrhage that had robbed her of her vitality and health for a dozen years. 12 years of trying this miracle cure and that miracle remedy, only to hear doctors say, "I hate to tell you this, but you're getting worse rather than better." She thought she had no hope. She lived a life of loneliness. She was ceremonially unclean throughout all of these 12 years. But then she heard of a man named Jesus. a man who they said could heal with a word from his lips or a touch of his hand. And she thought, as a last resort, maybe, just maybe, he could do something for my situation. And so she gathers her courage and she leaves her house and she goes to where she hears Jesus is, and she sees him in the distance as he's knotted and clothed with a mass of people all around him. And she thinks, you know what? A guy doesn't have time for me. But then as she starts to leave, in her peripheral vision, she catches a glimpse of his robe flowing in the breeze. And she thinks there's power in that man, and perhaps it even stretches all the way to his garment. And so she moves closer and closer, and with every single step, her faith continues to swell. And finally, she gets so close that she knifes her shoulder in between two burly fishermen, and she reaches out and she touches his garment. Immediately, she relinquishes the grasp and fades back into the crowd. The Gospel of Mark says, immediately she knew. Gone was that perpetual sense of pain, replaced by an inward sense of healing. The bleeding had stopped, and for the very first time in 12 years, she could stand up straight and look the world straight in the eyes, for she had touched the great physician, and she would never be the same again. But then Jesus, with that unassuming manner which he so often liked to take, suddenly whirled in the crowd, and he said, "Who touched me?" And the disciples said, "What? Who touched me? You're asking, who touched me? Lord, there are people pressing against you from all sides, and yet you ask, who touched me?" But Jesus could always distinguish between the casual jostling of the crowd and the purposeful touch of someone in need. And power had gone from him, and he would find the person who had claimed it. And so with love, he looked at each person in that crowd until finally his eyes met hers. And when they did, she fell in a heap on the ground right before him. And Jesus looked at her after she had blurted out her entire story and told her entire testimony of what had just happened. Jesus looked at her and said, "Your faith, not my garment, but your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed." I have a strange suspicion that she did, because once you have a personal encounter with Jesus Christ, you will never be the same again. Now, that was her story. It's a story both of desperation and also of deliverance. And so what I thought we would do today is we're gonna dig in, and we're gonna look at four different observations that we can make from this story. But in addition to that, we're gonna look at three takeaways that we can have. So let's lock in and dive into observation number one. She's all alone, but Jesus notices her. She's all alone, but Jesus notices her. The Bible says that this woman had battled this ongoing illness for 12 years. This story occurs in Matthew, Mark, and Luke's gospel, three different accounts of the same story. Mark's gospel that we have before us says that she suffered under the care of many doctors. Luke's account, Luke is a doctor. When Luke writes about it, he's a little more forgiving to people in the profession. So he doesn't say she suffered under the care of many doctors. He says she suffered from an incurable disease. And so we understand just a little bit of their personalities in this. Let me paint a picture of you for what it was like for a Jewish woman to have this chronic condition at that time. You see, due to the Old Testament laws found in the book of Leviticus, this ongoing health issue would have negatively affected every single area of her life. If she was married, she was not allowed to touch her husband. She couldn't make a meal because it would be considered unclean for anyone else. She couldn't even enter into the temple. So she had to feel incredibly alone. This is a story of desperation, financially, socially, relationally, spiritually. And her loneliness is quite evident. Why did Jesus insist on calling out this woman in the crowd? I mean, think about it. Jesus could have just been walking along, felt the power went out from him. He could have just kind of glanced back. He knew who it was. He's Jesus. He could have just glanced at her, winked like, "You're good now. It's all good." But he didn't do that. Instead, Jesus brought attention to her and had her share her story. She wanted to go unnoticed. But Jesus didn't let her do that because people needed to hear her story. I've been in ministry for over 3 decades, and one thing that I have observed is that some people, when they come to Christ, they want their decision to go unnoticed. They want the assurance of forgiveness. They want eternal life, but they don't want their family to know about the decision because they might get upset. And they don't want their work friends to know because the cultural war is just really heating up. And they don't want church leaders to know the decision that they've made in their heart because the church leaders might start recruiting them and asking them to serve in some capacity at church. But Jesus Christ doesn't allow us to have an anonymous encounter or a private healing for very long. He calls us to share that with others. In Luke chapter 9, verse 26, Jesus says, "If anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes into his glory." Well, here's a second observation that I want us to make. She's so discouraged, but Jesus encourages her. So she's alone, but Jesus notices her. But now she's discouraged, and so Jesus encourages her. He wanted her faith to be in him, not in his robe. He didn't want her to have the mistaken notion that there was some magic power in an inanimate object. And we need to remember that our faith is not in a statue. It's not in a picture. It's not in a building. It's not in a necklace. Our faith is in Jesus Christ. And that's what we hold on to. Look in your Bible at Mark chapter 5, verse 29. It says, "And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. And Jesus, perceiving in himself the power had gone out from him," let's stop right there. The power comes from Jesus, as does the attention. The attention shifts over to her so that her story can be heard. But immediately she's encouraged through the healing. But also, she's encouraged because Jesus Christ notices her. And there's a takeaway in here for us that we have to grasp, and that is that God is counting on us to get out of our own little personal worlds and notice other people around us, to give them the time of day. What could happen, I wonder, if you were to send a positive word, an encouraging email, a smiling face, an arm about the shoulder, given to someone who needs some encouragement? I promise you that today or tomorrow, you will come across someone who's discouraged and to think that you have the power to lift their spirits. Well, here's the third observation for your note page. She's so overwhelmed, but Jesus gives her peace. She's so overwhelmed, but Jesus gives her peace. We all feel overwhelmed at times. If you are a mom or a dad at any of our campuses, just put your hands up, okay? All right? You ever feel overwhelmed? Right? There are times where you say, "Oh, this is great. We've got summer, but we've got vacation coming up as a family." And then you get on about the fourth or fifth day of that vacation, and you feel overwhelmed. It's supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be relaxing, but whoa, it's become taxing, right? And you start to say, "Well, I can't wait till we get back home and we get in our routine." It's not just for those of us who are older that feel overwhelmed. Even young people do as well. I have a grandson who was in kindergarten a year and a half ago. He went off to kindergarten, was quite nervous about it, and my daughter had packed lunch for him. And when the day of school was over, JR came home from school, and she looked in his stuff and saw that he had not even touched his lunch. And she could tell that he was a little bit nervous. And she said, "Hey, JR, how did everything go at school today, kindergarten, for the first day?" He said, It went really good, but I don't think I'm going to go back tomorrow." Well, sometimes we just feel overwhelmed, right? And it's in those moments when we feel overwhelmed where we have to invite the Lord into the equation. This woman is tired, she's discouraged, she's overwhelmed. An ongoing discharge of blood would cause anemia and major fatigue. And to be willing to even get out of your house and into a crowd would have taken a lot of courage. Satan was probably whispering to her, "Well, what if you get too tired? What if he's too far away and you don't have the energy to walk all that ways? What if you pass out?" Not to mention the fact that she was supposed to be in a self-imposed quarantine, and if anyone did stumble across her who knew of her condition, it could be very bad. She would be publicly judged. And everybody she touched would themselves be considered unclean for several days. But maybe this nameless woman had heard that Jesus had healed a leper. And not only had he healed a leper, but if you remember the story, before he healed the leper, he touched the leper. And maybe this woman thought in her mind and deduced, if that's the case, if he touched someone who was unclean, maybe an unclean person could touch him. Once healed, her joy quickly gave way to fear when Jesus stopped and said, "Who touched me?" Look back in your Bible at Mark 5, verse 32 and 33. And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. So this is really cool. She recognizes the divine power of Jesus. Fear and trembling are natural responses when you are in the presence of the divine. When Jesus calmed the storm, you remember that? This massive storm's going on. Jesus is asleep in the boat. The disciples are right there. You remember what happens? Jesus, they wake him up. He gets up, and he just says, "Peace, be still." It's like glass, right? And the Bible says that the disciples are filled with great fear. Who is this who the wind and the waves obey him, right? Why are they filled with great fear? Because they are in the presence of the divine, and it hits them in that moment. In this same chapter, in Mark chapter 5, the Gadarene demoniac, this demon-possessed man in the rocks and cliffs of the Gadarenes, is healed. And when he's healed, instead of everybody rejoicing and going crazy, the people of the town say, "Hey, you know what? You need to go someplace else." Why do they say that? Because they're afraid. They're afraid of what's taking place. They've never been around deity. They don't know what to do with that. But in this setting, with this woman, Jesus is not about to let this go. And so Jesus is going to make certain that he identifies her. I really like this. The word that's chosen in the Gospels when it describes the crowd that's there with Jesus, you know what the word means that's chosen to describe a crowd there? It says a large group of unidentified people. So they were all unidentified people, but Jesus was on a mission. He was going to make certain that he identified one of them. He was going to make certain that he called her out in a loving way so that she could share her story. He doesn't ask, "Who touched me for his sake?" He asks, "Who touched me for her sake and for the sake of the others who would hear the story?" And this bold, reckless, nameless person falls at the feet of Jesus, explaining everything. How then does Jesus give her peace while she's overwhelmed? Well, Jesus looks at her and he says, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be freed from your disease." He says, "Daughter." That's how he starts. Don't miss this. When Jesus calls her daughter, this is the only time in all the Gospels that Jesus ever refers to a woman as daughter. In that one word, he reveals who she is and who he is. She's part of a family now. You don't have to be overwhelmed. You can be at peace because we have a relationship. And he says the same thing to each and every one of us. I want you in my family. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, he says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here." And so she's alone. She's discouraged. She's overwhelmed. And here's the final observation. She's in such pain, but Jesus intervenes. Notice that Jesus can help and heal both outwardly and inwardly. The psalmist said it like this, and I love this verse, Psalm 34, verse 18. I put it on the screen for you. It says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Don't you take solace in the fact that when your heart is broken, and I know at every campus, I know in every single row, there is a broken heart. There's something that's going on in your life right now, And you hold on to that fact and realize that God is the one who is close to the brokenhearted and who saves those who are crushed in spirit. Jesus heals her instantly. My fear is that we get so wrapped up in the physical healing, we get so wrapped up in the material things that sometimes we forget about what our greatest need is. We ask God time and time again, oh, I want this, I need that, and help our house to sell, and Lord, help her to get accepted into that college. And we go through all of our wish lists of all the things that we want. And in our heart of hearts, we somehow think that our greatest need in life is to improve the way we look or to improve our health. And there's nothing wrong with those things, but there is a greater need. Our greater need is Jesus Christ, to have a personal relationship with Him, to actively work that relationship with Him. It's not for a larger paycheck. It's not for a steady relationship. It's not for a bigger house in a nicer neighborhood. Our greatest need is Jesus. And in this woman's life, she begins to realize that all the other things pale in comparison. And yes, Jesus heals her, but I think it's just the start of a great relationship. You know, this story truly is a story of deliverance, and the deliverance grew out of desperation. So let's spend our remaining time just taking a look at some takeaways. Takeaway number one, inconveniences can become opportunities. Inconveniences can become opportunities. What if you began to view your daily interruptions as openings to minister to others? Your struggles, you began to see them as a chance to encourage others. You know, it's interesting because Ken Blanchard, who wrote the book, The One-Minute Manager, says it like this. He says, if it weren't for interruptions, Jesus Christ would not have had a ministry. And he's right. Every day Jesus got up, he walked out of wherever he was staying, and once people started seeing him, they just started coming to him, and his entire agenda was just being there for other people, making a difference in their lives. What if the struggles that you've gone through, what if the pain that you've experienced, what if the relational heartbreak that has manifested itself through some friendships in your life or through some other relationship, what if God allowed you to go through that pain so that you can minister to other people? That's a different way to look at things. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, I love this verse. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort that we ourselves receive from God. In other words, God got you through a difficult time in your life. Now maybe you can help someone else who goes through something that's similar. And just like in this woman's life, God may use you because of your success that you've experienced. But more times than not, God uses you because of the failure or the pain that you've experienced. And if you've gone through some physical problem, if you've gone through some relational separation, if you've gone through emotional pain or grief, you are primed and ready for God to use you to share that story and to help other people. God will get your story out there if He wants it told. And I love the fact that Jesus draws this woman out of the crowd. I've got a full manuscript up here that whenever I preach, I have things written out here pretty much word for word, and then I end up adding some things in some places, you know. But I've worked hard on this. I have this all typed out. I've got 13 pages of notes here. But no, I'm sorry if I scared you. I just lost a few of you. Whoa, need to go get a haircut, right? Didn't need it when I came in. But this woman, he puts on the spot. Now, she wasn't some public speaker. Jesus just puts her on the spot, and what does she do? She comes forward, she falls before him, and she tells the whole story. That's what evangelism is. It's just sharing your story. It's not a paid professional whose mouth moves on cue. It's you telling someone else the difference that Jesus Christ has made in your life. And you may want to remain unnoticed, but there will be times in the break room at work or in the backyard by the fence in your subdivision where all of a sudden God pulls you out and says, you can't go unnoticed. You need to share your story. And I pray. I pray that we will have the faith and the boldness, a reckless faith to say, I'm going for it. I'm just going to tell the difference that Jesus Christ has made in my life. I mean, if he really is the Lord and he really is the master of your life, we should be able to talk about him, shouldn't we? And that's what this woman does. We all have some things that we're not proud of. I'm sure she wasn't real proud of the details of her story as she's sharing some of the physical problems that she's experienced in front of this throng of people. I guarantee you she's probably wishing, oh, I wish I would have just had a broken arm instead of having to go through this and sharing it. But God takes your story and what you have experienced and how Jesus intervenes and he allows it to minister to other people. You see, we all have some details of our story that we're just not crazy about. Maybe it was a season of our life where we made some poor choices. Maybe it's a dysfunctional family tree that we're just not real proud of. Maybe it's an ongoing struggle or battle for years with alcohol or drug abuse. Maybe for you, you're a workaholic, and that's your drug. And your family pays the price because you have this desire to climb the ladder of success, and it's kind of out of kilter. Maybe it's your past. Maybe it's something that took place that you would rather keep quiet, and you really don't want it to come out in public. Well, regardless of what it is for you, here's the good news. Jesus can change your direction. His Spirit can alter your actions. He can forgive your sins. The Bible says as far as the east is from the west, he can banish your sins. He can remember them no more. Your grace is on our side. That's what we say, and that's what we sing to God. And sometimes I think when people come to Harvest, they come here because they've gone through a difficult time. They've gone through some type of pain. They just need a fresh start, and they need to go someplace where they can heal for a while. And maybe you came in here, and you came in here, and you wanted to be unnoticed. I think that's what's going on with this woman. 12 years of being an outcast. She doesn't want any attention from Jesus. She just wants to be healed, and yet Jesus calls attention to it. Why? Because God's power of healing and transformation is a story that you just can't keep quiet. And if God has done a work in your life and he has changed you, you can't keep that to yourself. Here's the second takeaway as I see it. We must see people for their potential rather than their problems. We must see people for their potential rather than their problems. My friend Chip Ingram spoke here at Harvest for your all's Easter services just a few months ago. Chip likes to say, have you ever come across one of those folks who is a EGR person? You say, what's EGR stand for? Extra grace required. And you know the person that I'm talking about. You immediately, when I say that, you've got a picture in your mind. You can see that person. If you're out somewhere at the store and all of a sudden you see that person walking toward you, it's like, oh no, where do I go? How can I exit from here, right? They're extra grace required people. They're people that can become a little bit more draining to you rather than life-giving to you, right? And so as a result of that, you find yourself shying away from them. And yet Jesus constantly was reaching out to people like that. You think of the brash, bullying coworker who constantly condemns and regularly ridicules the rest of the team. You think of the sullen, rebellious teen who's going through a tough time. And so they lash out at others. What is it that we say? Hurt people, right? Did you all hear about the meanest woman in the world? Don't look around. She's not in your row, all right? She's actually worshiping at Rolling Meadows this morning. Sorry. Meanest woman in the world. She worked as a receptionist at a doctor's office. And one time, a mild-mannered guy came in, and as he was signing in, he said, yes, he said, I'm here to see the doctor. I'm going to have this mole removed. She said, third door on your left, take off all your clothes. He said, I don't think you heard what I said. I've got an appointment to see the doctor. I've got a mole here on my chin, and I'm supposed to see him in a few minutes. She said, I don't think you heard what I said. I said, third door on your left, take off all your clothes. He said, we have a communication problem here. He said, it's just a tiny mole. She said, we do have a communication problem. You are not doing what I told you to do. Third door on your left, take off all your clothes. He went, okay. He went walking down. He found the third door on the left. He went inside there. He shut the door. He started disrobing. About that time, he looked over in the corner. There's a guy wearing boxer shorts. Guy said, man alive, that woman out there, she's a pit bull. The other guy said, tell me about it. I'm the UPS driver. So we've all met people like that, right? I think sometimes God crosses our paths with people like that so that maybe we can try to encourage them. Maybe we can come alongside of them. Maybe we can give them a little bit of hope. Sometimes if you know the backstory of someone, it reveals why it is they act or speak the way that they do. You know, my favorite line in this account of this story is not found in Mark's gospel. It's actually found in Luke's gospel. And I'm going to put it on the screen for you. Here's my favorite line. Then the woman, this is Luke 8:47, then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. That leads us to the final takeaway. No one escapes the notice of an all-seeing God. Seeing that she could not go unnoticed. Now, some of you hear me say that, and that's not a relief to you. You see it as something bad. You see it like, oh, God is constantly watching me, and he's waiting for me to screw up or make a mistake, and he's going to be mad at me. No, that's not what I mean. Yes, he does see every single thing that you do, but understand it this way. He is a loving father who cares deeply for you and wants you to make wise and correct decisions. And because of that, he is watching us, but he notices you. He knows you. He knows your name. He knows the number of hairs on your head. He loves you that much. He is that personally involved. Not only is he a powerful God, he is a personal God. Psalm 139, if you want to read something this afternoon, where can I run from your presence? Where can I hide from your eyes? It's impossible to do. If I go to the depths of the sea, you are there. If I go to the height of the mountain, you're there. Your right hand is there to guide me. He notices us. And this story of this physically hampered woman who reaches out to Jesus is a story of desperation. Desperation that leads us to the one who excels in transformation. And I'm telling you what, you might want transformation in your life. You might say, oh boy, you know what, I need some transformation. But until you swallow your pride and reach out to him, you don't have a prayer. I don't have a prayer. He's our only hope. You can't put your past truly in your past without Jesus being part of it. Because in and of yourself, if you could change your life, if you could conquer that addiction or that ongoing besetting sin or struggle, if you could control your tongue, if you could keep, let's say, just the Ten Commandments, if you could do that on your own, then the God of the universe made a tragic mistake when he sent Jesus to earth to live a perfect life and to die an atoning death for you. You see, you're not perfect and I'm not perfect. We all make mistakes. And that's why God sent Jesus, because he's the only one who can transform us. And this woman was healed because she was desperate and she saw Jesus as her only hope. And when you come to that point of saying, Jesus, you are my only hope, that's when salvation becomes real. Because you realize that Jesus is the only one who can do it. The height of your transformation will be determined by the depth of your repentance. This is a woman who was an outcast. And Jesus looks at her and says, you're no outcast, you're family now. unknown, unclean, living in a man's world, and yet Jesus treated her like she was the only person on the face of the earth. And he promises to do the same for you, and he is looking at you, and he says, daughter. He says, son. And he notices you, and he knows your hurts. He knows your pain. He knows every struggle. He knows every injustice that you have ever experienced. You may have been coming to Harvest, and when you started coming here, you just wanted to remain anonymous. You just wanted to go unnoticed for a while. And maybe you said, you know, I'm just going to kind of sit on the sidelines. I'm going to be spiritually fed by God's word, but I don't want to attract any attention. Well, I understand that. I really do. But the problem is that for some of you, that was 6 months ago, or that was 3 years ago. And you still are content to be a spectator and to sit on the sidelines and to hold back in your relationship with the Lord. I don't know what your next step is that in your walk with the Lord. I don't know if you need to accept him. I don't know if you need to recommit yourself to him. I don't know if you need to become more bold in sharing your testimony. I don't know what that next step is, but I am confident that the Holy Spirit will lay it on your heart. And then the question will be whether or not you step out of the crowd and are willing to be noticed, and you're willing to share your story with others, and you're willing to say, I need to grow in my faith. You know, one of my favorite things whenever I'm at Harvest that I love the most about your weekend worship is when I get to watch a baptism video, because I get a peek into that person's story. And they didn't write out 13 pages. Whoever it is just asks them a question, and they dig in a little bit, and they say, when did you decide to make Christ the Lord of your life? Tell me a little bit about that. And we get a peek into their story, and we walk away and we feel like we know them, but we also hear of the difference that Jesus Christ has made in their life. I'm just here to tell you today, he can make that difference in your life too. Don't go unnoticed any longer. Let the Lord know that you're ready. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we praise you that you look for us, that you look for me, the same way you looked for that woman in that crowd. And we thank you that you identified her, and that you identify us, and that you identify with us. You are perfect. Do your work in us. Unfold your plan according to your will and not ours. And give us a bold and reckless faith to match your overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love. It's in the powerful name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.